जस्ट 2 मिनट गाइस। यस गाइस, सो इफ यू रिकॉल वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट 1872 एंड वी हैव सीन टिल नाउ 3 टॉपिक्स, राइट? फर्स्ट वन इज नेचर एंड काइंड्स ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, सेकंड वन इज ऑफर एंड एक्सेप्टेंस, एंड थर्ड वन इज कंसिडरेशन। सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट दिस इंट्रोडक्शन, राइट, इफ यू रिमेंबर, we have said that the Indian Contract Act can be divided into 2 parts, which is general contracts, which is covered in chapter number 126 and has got section number 1 to 75, and then secondly we have got special contracts, which is not a part of our syllabus, right, which is not a part of our syllabus because it is covered in CA Inter. Okay, so special contracts is chapter number 8 to chapter number 10. 7 and 11, which where a part of Indian Contract Act has been omitted because they have made separate laws relating to it. 7 was dealing with sale of goods, which is now a new act altogether, that is Sale of Goods Act. And then if I talk about chapter number 11, which is nothing but provisions relating to partnership, that is again a part of that is a separate act now, which is Indian Partnership Act. Theek hai na? So general principles, section number 1 to 75, chapter number 1 to 6, general contracts, general principles of the law of contract. Special contracts is chapter number 8 to 10, section number 124 to 238, which is not a part of our syllabus, that is covered in CA Inter. As far as 7 and 11 is concerned, as you know, that is omitted and made a separate law. Then talking about the jus in personam, this is a Latin maxim. If you can recall, jus in personam means right against a specified person. ठीक है, फिर जस्ट इन रेम इज राइट अगेंस्ट अ पर्टिकुलर थिंग. द इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट इज बेस्ड ऑन विच पर्टिकुलर लैटिन मैक्सिम? जस्ट इन पर्सोनेम, करेक्ट, जस्ट इन पर्सोनेम. सो दैट मींस वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ व्हाट? पर्संस, फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ द राइट्स एंड लाइबिलिटीज ऑफ अ पर्सन. देन व्हेनेवर वी टॉक अबाउट सम सेक्शन नंबर, इफ यू रिमेंबर आई हैव टोल्ड यू दिस सेक्शन नंबर्स डिनोट व्हाट? सेक्शन नंबर्स ऑफ द इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट 1872, अनलेस वी स्पेसिफाई सम अदर एक्ट. Then talking about section number 1, okay, before that preamble also we have discussed. If you can recall the preamble, preamble says what? That it is about coming up with some provisions relating to the contract, okay, coming up with some regulations relating to the contracts, or if there are already some provisions, already there are some regulations, then they're trying to modify them, they're trying to amend those particular regulations. That's the idea. So create the new provisions or regulations or amend the existing ones. That's the basic idea behind this particular Indian Contract Act 1872. Okay, then talking about section 1, which is going to specify 3 items: title, applicability date and extent. Title is the Indian Contract Act 1872. Applicability date is 1st of September 1872, right? And then extent, when we talk about, which is geographical extent, is whole of India. This act applies to what? Whole of India. Okay, just ping me. Are you able to follow me? Are you able to hear me properly? Just say yes if you are able to. Quickly. Okay, great. Now moving forward, if we talk about definition of contract. Clause H, section 2, clause H gives the definition of contract, which says an agreement enforceable by law is a contract. So in short, we can say contract is equals to an agreement plus enforceability. Then the question comes, what is an agreement? So we said agreement means nothing but every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. So basically we said agreement is nothing but promise plus promise, one party promising and the other party reciprocating by way of his promise. And then when we say what is promise, that is nothing but an offer when accepted becomes promise. Okay, so contract is agreement plus enforceability, agreement is equals to promise plus promise, and promise is equals to nothing but offer plus acceptance. Contract is defined under section 2 clause H, right? Agreement is defined under 2 clause E, and then when we talk about promise, that is 2 clause B, correct? Promise kahan par defined hai? 2 clause B. Okay, then we know another thing, that every agreement is not a contract, but every contract is certainly an agreement, right? So it's important to understand that the first point is nothing but agreement. Only if there's an agreement, then there can be a contract. That's why we are saying that every contract will have an agreement, right? Every agreement may not be a contract, for the simple reason that if agreement is not supported by legal enforceability, then it can't be a contract. So it's important to understand contract is equals to agreement plus enforceability. So every agreement can't be contract unless it is enforceable. So now the question comes, what is enforceability? And as I've told you, enforceability means nothing but going to court of law and court of law compelling the parties to perform, right? Making it compulsory for the parties to perform. So that means agreement should be always supported by enforceability, then only it becomes a contract, right? So the law, the Indian Contract Act has not defined this term enforceability, right? They have not defined this term enforceability. However, they have given some essential elements of a valid contract, isn't it? There are some essential elements for a valid contract, or we may say there are some conditions of enforceability which are given under section number 10, right? So what are those 10 conditions which we have discussed? If you remember, there must be an offer by one party and its acceptance by the other party, right? The offer must be given to whom? To the party to whom they want the acceptance to be given. So if I want the offer to be given to Naman, if I want acceptance from Naman, then I must be giving the offer to Naman specifically, correct? So there must be an offer by one party and its acceptance by other. That is where agreement would come into picture. Otherwise, agreement cannot come, right? And then there shall be an agreement on the same thing in the same sense. If you can recall, we said there must be a mutual consent of the parties. That means agree upon the same thing in the same sense. So that means there should be identity of minds, right? There should be nothing but meeting of minds, right? Consensus ad idem is the Latin maxim for it. Then, not just agreement and mutual consent, but there must be legal obligation, right? Not the social obligations, not any sort of moral obligation. We expect what? There shall be an invitation. There shall be an intention to create legal obligation. So if a person is calling other person for dinner, you know, there's a social obligation even if the other person accepts the same. So there's no question of enforceability. There's no question of going to the court of law and compelling. Then, if you remember, we said that in case of commercial agreements, always there is a presumption that the parties have an intention to create legal relations. Am I right? There's always an intention of what? Creating legal relations. In which case? In case of commercial agreements, not in case of social agreements. Okay. Then, there must be free consent of the parties. Right? When the parties are giving the consent, when the one of the parties is giving his acceptance, it should be always freely given. That means it should not be because of coercion, undue influence, fraud, misrepresentation, or maybe mistake. Then the parties must be competent to contract, right? The parties who are entering into a contract should always be what? Not minor, should not be of unsound mind, should not be the ones who are disqualified by law. That means basically we're trying to say that they shall be competent enough to enter into a contract. Then the agreement must be supported by lawful consideration. What is consideration? Something in return. Right. So if I am giving something, if I'm promising something, I should also get in return something. Right. And what should I get in return? That will be at my desire. Because when I give an offer, I will specify what do I want from the other party. Right. Right. So in that case, the person who's giving acceptance obviously will have to reciprocate that way only. And that consideration has to be lawful consideration. And that lawful consideration will depend upon the legality of consideration will depend upon what? Will depend upon the legality of the object, isn't it? Will depend upon the legality of the object. Okay. So the object, next one is, as you know, the object of the agreement must be lawful, correct? And when we say the object must be lawful, that means what? It should not be fraudulent. It should not be forbidden, that is prohibited by law. It should not be immoral. It should not be opposed to public policy. Then, the agreement must not be expressly declared to be void by the law of the country. Right? That's also important that whatever agreement we do, if the law itself doesn't allow us, then it is wrong. So it is an important factor that it should be always allowed by law. It should not be expressly declared to be void by law. Then the agreement must be certain. There shall not be uncertainty. There shall not be vagueness. If you remember the same example, right? I've taken multiple times now that if let's say I'm dealing in 100 type of oils and I don't specify which type of oil I want to offer or I want to sell, then it becomes uncertain. If I have 5 bungalows and I want to sell one of the bungalows, which one I have not specified, then there is uncertainty. If I have 3 scooters, 3 cars, and I don't specify which one I want to sell, then there is uncertainty. So that is not going to be right. Right? And then performance must not be impossible to perform. That means it should not be real. It should be real. It should not be illusory. It should not be just imagination of your mind. It should not be just what you think, but it should be possible to perform. But we said rather we shall be always writing it as what? It shall not be impossible to perform, right? It should not be impossible to perform. So this way we have talked about certain essentials of a valid contract. Okay, certain essentials of a valid contract. So this is coming out from where? Section 10, right? Section number 10. Essentials of a valid contract, or we can say the conditions for enforceability. Then next one after this, okay, after the definition of contract and the conditions of enforceability, we have talked about kinds or classification of contracts, wherein we said there can be different bases. So on the basis of enforceability, we said there can be valid contract. Valid contract means contract enforceable by law. Void contract means not enforceable by law, right? So two clause J defines this particular term, void contract. Wherein what? Void contract means which ceases to be enforceable by law, right? So maybe in the beginning that particular contract was valid, but later on it became void. So when it became void, that means it became not enforceable, because void contract means it is not enforceable in the court of law. Then voidable contract, which is defined under two clause I defines voidable contract, which means nothing but a contract which is what you say at the option. That contract can be at the option of the agreed party. The agreed party may decide to keep the contract valid or maybe to make the contract void. So it is purely at the desire of the aggrieved party, right? When do you think the contract can be voidable? So we took one example. We said when coercion is used for taking acceptance, or maybe when undue influence is used for taking acceptance, that is the time where we may find that the contract is voidable at the option of that aggrieved party. Then we have some differences between voidable contract and void contract. Then we talked about even unenforceable contract in this category. So what is unenforceable contract? Not enforceable in court of law. What is void contract? So we said the same thing. But the difference between these two is whenever we say Section 10 requirements are not complied with, whenever any one particular requirement also of the Section 10 is not complied with, then we will use the term void contract. But when we talk about some other problem, some other defects, some technical defects, okay, that means some other requirements have not been satisfied, then it will become unenforceable contract, right? So come again, void contract means not enforceable. Unenforceable also means not enforceable. But the basic difference is when we talk about void contract, we are talking about Section 10 requirement may be not fulfilled. But whereas unenforceable means some other special requirement which is there, some other technical requirement which is there, that is not fulfilled. Then illegal contract, right? On the basis of legality or enforceability, we said illegal contract. So the object itself is unlawful. I hope you remember collateral transactions. Collateral transactions means the connected transactions. Like if A says that please go and kill C, okay, A says to whom? Let's say B, that go and kill C. Now, because of this, let's say B enters into a contract with some person D who will supply him gun or who will supply him, let's say, knife. Then what will happen in that case? The contract between A and D is the main contract, okay, illegal contract, and the contract between this B and D will be a collateral transaction. So you know, illegal transactions, illegal contract is void, and also the collateral transactions to the illegal ones are void, right? That is not the case in case of void contract. You know, void contract, not enforceable. But does it mean that collateral transactions to void contract also is not enforceable? No, it may be enforceable, right? So illegal is void, collateral to illegal is also void. And then void agreement may not always result in the penalty, but illegal will certainly result in penalty. Then also we said all void agreements are not illegal, but every illegal agreement is void, correct? Then, so this was on the basis of the first one, that is nothing but legal validity, okay, or enforceability. Second basis which we took for understanding the types of contract was formation or mode of creation. In that case, we said express contract. Express contract means contract made in writing or by word of mouth. That means it can be oral, it can be written. Implied contract means act or maybe conduct. So when we say act or conduct, what does it mean? Maybe example, if you just recall, right? We said the bus which is plying on the road, right, is implying. Is implying what? That you can come onto that particular bus and the bus will take you to that particular destination. And in case you get onto that particular bus, you have implied that you want to enter into a contract. They were like, what, interested in going to that destination, and you were also interested, you have gone into the bus. So it is an implied contract which is happening here, because maybe no words spoken by anyone, but still that there's a contract which come into place. Or you went to a restaurant, self-service restaurant, and you took a cup of tea. That means you've implied that you will pay for that particular cup of tea. That is implied. Implied means by act, by conduct, or maybe by omission also sometimes, correct? Then quasi contract means what? The quasi contract means which is not created by the parties, but created by law. When the law creates it, that is where this comes into existence. Like if you remember, I forgot my laptop, and then maybe Mayank finds this laptop and gets it to me. Then what happens in that case? I have a duty to pay off the charges which he has incurred to return back that particular laptop to me. Right. So this is nothing but obligation imposed by law. Right. So quasi contract means always contract created by law. Isn't it? So, and does the law uses this term quasi contract? The answer is no. Law never uses the word quasi. It's we guys practically who are using, the courts which are using. Then tacit contract means inferred from the conduct of the parties. Like we said, auction sale, if we talk about auction sale, will be happening only when there is fall of hammer, right? Striking of hammer on the table should happen. That is where the contract will come into place. Or maybe some customary mode should be used, right? Going, gone, or maybe 1, 2, 3, one time, two times, three times. Something has to be done, right? Some conduct has to be there. Then only the contract might come. So it's not just offer and acceptance there, but something else also required there. That is what will be called as tacit contract. Then e-contracts, anyways, e-commerce contracts. So this is how we've talked about the second basis in the types of contract. Third basis, we said on the basis of performance. So here we said we will classify it into two: at the time of formation of contract, and then second is after creation of the contract. At the time of formation, that means when the contract is getting formed, at that time, which terms are used? Unilateral contracts or contract with executed consideration, right? And second one is bilateral contract or contract with executory consideration. Whereas when we talk about after formation of the contract, you know, we use the term executory contract and executed contract, isn't it? So when at the time of formation of contract, one of the parties have already performed his part. At the time of formation contract, if one of the parties has already performed his part and the other one is supposed to do his bit, then it is called as what? Unilateral contract. At the time of formation, we'll call it as unilateral. Okay. And this is also called as contract with executed consideration, because one of the parties has already performed his part. Whereas when you say at the time of formation of the contract, both the parties are yet to perform, then it becomes what? Bilateral contract or contracts with executory consideration. Contracts with what? Executory consideration. Correct. Then after formation of the contract, we said, when both the parties have performed their part fully, then it can be called as executed contract. That means none of the parties have to perform anything there. So it's completely executed. This word we'll use after formation. But there is a possibility at the time of formation only, if let's say both have performed their part, then you can straight away call it as what? Executed contract. You remember I've discussed this and we've taken that example, Tommy Choo Choo, if you remember, Akanksha, Madam Amit, right? Then executory contract. Executory contract means one of the parties is yet to perform or both the parties are yet to perform. Correct. After formation of the contract, when you say both the parties are yet to perform or one of the parties is yet to perform, that is called as what? Executory contract. Isn't it? So these were the types of contracts. Then as per English law, that's fine. Contract under seal. That means you're talking about that is in writing, signed, sealed and delivered. Whereas when you talk about maybe let's say some court or some authority giving some judgment and that is being used, then it is contract of record. Correct. So this way we have talked about the first topic, that is nothing but nature and kinds of contract. And after that, we have understood that when we talk about our topics or the topics which we have, is nothing but actually essential elements of valid contract, isn't it? Because one of the essential elements is offer and acceptance, then consideration, then free concern, capacity to contract. These topics which we are studying now is nothing but essential elements of valid contract only. Right, guys? Just say yes if you're able to follow me, if you're able to hear me. Okay, great. Now, talking about top, and I hope you're noting down your doubts so that when we go to our next session, next part of the session, we will take up doubts. So you please note down with page number and topic wherever you have doubts. So next, let's go for topic number two, that is offer and acceptance. The definition of offer comes from two clause A, which says what? That offer means what? Expressing one's willingness, expression of one person's willingness to do or abstain from doing something, right? So he wants the other party to do something or maybe not to do something. Such an offer is being made with an intention to take the acceptance from the other party. So he's not just making an offer for the sake of it, but he wants an acceptance from the other party to such act or abstinence, right? So the other party who's giving acceptance is giving acceptance for what purpose? For the purpose of that act or the for the purpose of that abstinence. Okay, this is given in 2 clause A. Section 2 clause A of what? Section 2 clause A of the Indian Contract Act 1872. Correct. Then, once the acceptance given, the parties are called as what? Promisor, promisee. The persons are called as promisor, promisee. Before acceptance is given, the person can be called as offerer or proposer, right? The person who's giving offer is offerer or proposer. And the other person to whom the offer is given is called as offeree, right? It's called as offeree. But don't use the term proposee. I've told you earlier as well. It's only offeree, which is being used there, right? Then, coming to essential elements of valid offer. The offer must be communicated to the other party to be accepted, because if the other party is not having the knowledge or the idea about the offer, how do you expect that particular person to give an acceptance to it? So it's very important that there shall be communication happening to the other party. And the offer must be made with a view to obtain the consent of offeree. Just now we said, if you don't have the, the person who's giving the offer doesn't have the intention to take acceptance, then they cannot make legally bound, right, each other then. The offer must not put the burden of acceptance on the offeree. That means he cannot write that if you don't reply, that means I will presume that as if you have given the acceptance. These type of things cannot be mentioned. Then the offer must have its terms definite, certain and clear. Vagueness will never help anyone, correct? Then the offer must be made with an intention of creating legal relationship. This is something self-explanatory now, right? The offer must express final willingness of the offerer, right? That means before giving the offer, let him think twice, thrice, 100 times. But once he give the offer, then he has to make sure that he'll stick to it. That's what we said. Now, so these were what? Some essential elements of a valid offer. Then proceeding further, we said some more important points relating to offer, including types of offer or classification of offers, right? So when we talk about the first point here, the offer may be made to world at large. Meaning, normally we say A making an offer to B, Akanksha making an offer to Amit, Amit making an offer to, let's say, Harsha. But then, is it only that way? No. The offer may be made to world at large as well, right? So there can be, so from this only we got to know offer can be specific offer or offer can be a general offer. Specific offer means offer made to an ascertained person, offer made to a specific person. Whereas general offer means what? Offer made to world at large. So in this case of general offer, who will be considered as offeree? The person who comes forward and gives his acceptance is called as what? Is called as offeree. Okay. Then the offer may be positive or negative, that is to do something or not to do something. Not to do something is also called as abstinence, isn't it? Is also called as abstinence. The offer may be express or implied. We have discussed this again. Express means oral written. Then cross offer do not result in contract. What is a cross offer? Cross offer means when I give an offer, right? When I give an offer, let's say to Ambika, and Ambika also is giving an identical offer to me. And the point is here that I don't know that she's giving some offer. She doesn't know my offer. Okay, she is not aware of my offer. I am not aware of her offer. And we are giving offer to each other. And these offers are crossing each other during transmission. Okay, during transmission. Then this is called as cross offer. So it's basically offer plus offer. And offer plus offer will never make a contract. Offer plus acceptance can make a contract, right? Then an invitation to offer is not an offer. Right. I'll again take you through those examples which we have discussed. We said maybe if we are talking about, let's say, newspaper advertisement, or we said prospectus, or when we talk about, let's say, self-service restaurant or goods in display in a showroom, right? So prospectus, I'll take the example of prospectus. Prospectus is an invitation to offer. And now the investor comes and says, yes, I want to subscribe the securities. So that's an offer given by him, and the company allots the securities to him. That means company has given acceptance. So there are three things here: invitation to offer, then offer, and then acceptance, right? Only when acceptance comes, that is the time we can say there's a contract in place or there's an agreement in place. And obviously if agreement satisfies that enforceability condition, then it becomes a contract. right? Or prospectus of a school or college, right? And then you go and fill up that application form. There is nothing but offer. And then they say, we'll give you admission. That is nothing but then acceptance. So prospectus was invitation to offer. We giving the application form by filling it up is offer. And then the student getting the admission is nothing but acceptance. And thereby the contract comes into place. If we talk about goods in a shop or in a showroom, kept in display, that's invitation to offer. So you pick it up and put it in the bucket or maybe the trolley bag or trolley, and then go and put it at the cash counter for billing purpose. And then they bill it. So three things are there. Display is invitation to offer. You putting it in the trolley and keeping it at the cash counter for billing is offer given by you. And then when they bill it, then it is acceptance. Right? That's how the contract comes into place, and thereby you'll have to pay for it. So we'll have to check, are there three elements involved? If you say three elements involved, then we'll have to categorize invitation to offer, offer and acceptance. If only two are there, like I gave a newspaper advertisement saying that, will you buy my bike? Is anyone interested in buying my bike for rupees 20,000? And let's say now Shruti came and said that, yes, I will buy your bike for rupees 30,000. That means what? There's an offer, there's an acceptance. That's it. Okay, so please understand, we'll have to check whether there are three elements in it or not. If three are there, then it may be invitation to offer, offer, and then acceptance. If two are there, then it simply becomes offer and acceptance. So identify the elements there, it becomes easy. Okay. Then we also said a mere statement of intention is not an offer. Mere statement of intention is not an offer, because if you just intend something, that might not be an offer. Right, that intention should result in your willingness, and that willingness should be communicated to the other party. That's where it will become an offer. Next, an offer, an answer to a question is never an offer. Someone asking you some question, like I ask you some question, right? That would you be writing the? Selling your bungalow for rupees 30 lakhs? Okay, to someone, if someone gives 30 lakhs to you and you answer some question of mine, does it mean you are selling your or you are offering to sell your bungalow? No. So please understand, simply answering a question can never be an offer, right? So this is how we talked about. Then coming to this classification of offer, which is again, nothing but a part of that only. General offer, specific offer, then offer given to a group of persons, then any one of the group members comes and gives acceptance is a valid acceptance, correct? However, that one person should be authorized, please understand. We have given offer to a group of persons. One among them has come and said, okay, I'm accepting it. Very good. But then in that case, what should happen? Please understand, that particular person should have the authority. If he's not having the authority, if people have not authorized him and he's still coming and giving acceptance, that he then it might be his individual acceptance, but not acceptance of the group. Right. Then talking about cross offers, already we have discussed counter offer. Next one is counter offer. What is counter offer? I'll give you a simple example, which I've given you earlier as well. That if I say that I'm ready to sell my bungalow, okay, my only bungalow for rupees 2 crores. And you say, okay, I'm ready to buy that bungalow, but not for 2 crores, only for 1.5 crore. So I gave an offer, and what you gave is also an offer. It's not an acceptance. And if at all you're calling that as an acceptance, please understand, my dear friends, that is conditional acceptance. You put a condition. You're saying I'm accepting, but subject to this condition. So that means in a way, the original offerer, that is in this example, me, has to again give acceptance. So there's an offer from my side and the other party is also giving me an offer to which I have to give acceptance. So this conditional acceptance itself is called as counter offer, which is also called as qualified acceptance, which is not a good type of acceptance because that will again need to be supported by acceptance, right? Okay. Then we also said the counter offer will amount to rejection of original offer. Counter offer will amount to what? Rejection of original offer. Automatically, it rejects the original offer. And then again, if the person comes and says, okay, I'm ready. So we'll say, now the original offer has come to an end. So now you're giving an offer only for which acceptance is required from the other party. Then standing offer or continuing offer or open offer, what does it mean? When a person gives an offer and says that this particular offer is valid up to so and so time, right? You can give your acceptance up to so and so time, or maybe you can give your acceptance to the time you want. That means reasonable time he's talking about. So that's standing or continuing offer. If you remember my example, I said I'm a tax consultant and want to give some services, and you say no, I don't need them. I still say, okay, no problem, keep my card. Whenever you need my services, do let me know. I'll be there to help you out, or I'll be there to give the services. Correct. So this is standing or continuing or open offer, right? So maybe there is a possibility. Sometimes the offer may be the standing offer as well. Right. So this was with respect to offer. In detail, we have understood about offer. Then we talked about acceptance. Acceptance is given in 2 clause B. So acceptance is nothing but consent given to the offer. And only when consent is given, that is the time we say there is a binding contract, isn't it? And I hope you remember this particular line, that is acceptance when offer is what a lighted match is to a train of gunpowder, right? Lighted match to is to a train of gunpowder, a train carrying the gunpowder. If you light a match and put it, what will happen? Fire will come out, right? And you cannot retract that. You cannot take back that because you have lighted the match and put it there. Same way, when offer is given and you have given your acceptance, right? There comes a contract. And if you're not performing later, then it will amount to breach of contract. Correct, my dear friends? Then, as essentials of a valid acceptance, that is, acceptance can be given only by the person to whom offer is given. So if I have given offer to Ambika, then acceptance should come from Ambika. But if I have given offer to the world at large, then anyone, right, among the world at large can come and give the acceptance. Then acceptance must be communicated to the offerer. Simply having that mental determination that, okay, I have accepted the offer is never going to help. You should come forward and communicate that to the offerer that, yes, look here, I am ready to accept your offer, right? I am agreeing to accept to what you have proposed. So that is required to be done, right? So you're communicating to whom? You're communicating to offerer himself, or maybe sometime his agent, right? If he has authorized agent, then you can communicate to his agent as well. Next, the acceptance must be communicated by a person who's having authority to accept. If you remember the example of interview, you come and give an interview at Topic Educations for the job of a teacher, and then the office boy next day says, come on, I've accepted your offer of teaching, come and teach at our academy. Is it going to be right? No, because acceptance must be given by the person who's having the authority. So it's very important. The person who's giving acceptance should have the authority to accept. Then mere silence cannot amount to acceptance, right? Mere silence cannot amount to acceptance. That means the person cannot say that if you don't reply, if you remain silent after listening to my offer, I will presume that it is an acceptance, right? It is like not putting a pressure on the offeree or the person to whom the offer is given. Then, as we said, the acceptance must be absolute and not unqualified. Okay. Sorry, it must not be qualified. That means it should not be conditional. It should be absolute and unconditional, unqualified. Isn't it? Otherwise, it may amount to counter offer, and counter offer puts an automatic end to the original offer. Then we also talked about the acceptance should be done in the prescribed manner. And what is prescribed manner? Obviously, whatever the parties prescribe, whatever the offerer prescribes. And in case he doesn't prescribe any particular manner, then it has to be a reasonable manner. And reasonable means depends upon facts and circumstances of each case, right? Reasonable means what? Depends upon facts and circumstances of each case. Like I have given you example, reasonable time. What is reasonable time? It changes as per the situation. When I'm talking about you playing in KBC and this Amitabh Bachchan sir says that, okay, you have your own time now. Right, that watch or that clock has stopped now, so you can take your time to answer. Does it mean you can take 2 days, 3 days, or 2 hours? No. What he means is there probably 5 to 10 minutes you can take at the most, right? So there 5 to 10 is reasonable. But then when you go to a sweet shop and want to try some sweets, so you say, "Bhaiya, please give me the sweets. I'll show it at home. I'll taste it at home, and then come back. Okay. If at all I don't want, I'll come back." There probably the reasonable time might be 2 to 3 hours. But when you buy a shirt, right, from a shop, and you say that I'll be returning it if in case my parents don't like, or maybe my brother says that I should not be taking the shirt, then there probably it might be a week as well. So reasonable always depend on facts and circumstances, whether it is reasonable manner, whether it is reasonable time or reasonable mode, correct? So the acceptance should be given in specific manner and some usual manner. The acceptance should be given within the time prescribed, or again within reasonable time, right? Then the acceptance should be given before the lapse of offer, because if there's no offer, then how can we say there's an acceptance? Every time when you talk about giving acceptance, it should be given before the offer lapses, before the offer, when the offer is alive, that time you can give the acceptance, correct? This one is a repetition only. Then acceptance may be expressed or implied. This also we have talked about, right? Then after this, we have talked about communication of offer and acceptance, right? Section 3 is talking about it, and the doubt or this particular thing comes up only when it is not face to face. If it is face to face, if the communication is happening face to face, then and there itself that gets communicated. But then if it is other than face to face, all those doubts comes in, and that's where the section 3, 4, 5 and help. Anyways, 3 talks about communication of offer, acceptance or revocation can be done expressly or orally, right? Expressly, that is written or oral, or implied, that is conduct, act or omission. Express, implied. In express, oral or written. In conduct, act or omission. Correct? This is section 3. How to communicate the offer, how to communicate the acceptance, how to communicate the revocation. Then, section 4 is about completion of communication of offer. So if you remember, completion of communication of offer will take place when the offer gets communicated to the offeree. When the offer is communicated to the offeree. When the offeree gets the knowledge of the offer. That is the time we can say completion of communication of offer takes place with respect to offerer as well as offeree. Right. When it comes to completion of communication of acceptance, if you can recall, there we said the position is different. With respect to offerer, with respect to offeree. With respect to offerer, when we talk about, what does it mean? It means that completion of communication of acceptance will take place when the letter of acceptance is put into course of transmission. That means when the letter of acceptance is posted, right? But as far as the acceptor is concerned, the offeree is concerned, for him, when will the completion of communication of acceptance going to take place? When the letter of acceptance reaches the offerer, right? That means the offerer comes to the gets an idea or comes to his knowledge about the acceptance. That's the time when we can say completion of communication of acceptance takes place with respect to acceptor, right? Then section 5 talks about time limit for revocation of offer. Till what time the offer can be revoked? So we said that depends upon completion of communication of offer with respect to offerer. So that means if at all the offerer wants to revoke his offer, he has to revoke it better before the letter of acceptance is posted. And in case of revocation of acceptance, it should be done before letter of acceptance reaches or comes to the knowledge of offerer. Correct? And then when it comes to completion of communication of revocation, that is again given in section number 4, which says what? That here we'll not talk about offer or offeree. Here we'll talk about who makes revocation and to whom revocation is sent. So as far as the person to whom the revocation is sent or who makes revocation, okay, first we'll talk about who makes revocation. For him, when will the communication be complete? As and when you say that the revocation is posted, okay? And for the other party, that is the person to whom revocation is made, for him we'll say when it comes to his knowledge. That means when he gets to know about it. That's the time the communication of the revocation is complete for that other person. Correct. We have taken some examples as well. So this was section 3, 4 and 5. Then if we talk about letter of acceptance and letter of revocation of acceptance reaches simultaneously, then which one will be valid? So we said normally whichever he opens first will be valid. And it's a presumption that any person will read first the shorter mode. And if telegram has been used for sending the revocation, any person, any rational person would read what? The telegram. So that means revocation will be valid. Okay. That means there is no contract in place. But just in case we say he has opened the letter of acceptance first. Okay. Then in that case, the acceptance becomes valid. So contract becomes enforceable. I mean, contract is valid. So thereby it will be enforceable. Okay. Then lapse of offer, that is a part of offer only. Section number 6 says when does offer comes to an end? By communication of notice of revocation. That means when the person is revoking his offer before the completion of acceptance happens, correct? So before the person, the other party gives acceptance, if I revoke my offer, offer comes to an end. Or by lapse of time, if there's a time fixed and that time gets over, or if there's no time fixed, then reasonable time, then offer comes to an end. By failure to accept condition precedent, that means if I have attached some conditions to my offer and the other person who's giving acceptance does not fulfill those particular conditions, then obviously the offer comes to an end. Then by death or the insanity of offerer, okay. And then in that case, we have discussed about even whether the fact of death or insanity comes to the knowledge of the other party. Because if it comes to the knowledge of the other party and till he gives the acceptance, it's not of any use. However, he is not aware of it, and that's where he has given acceptance. Then the contract becomes valid, and the legal heads will have to perform unless and until we say there is some personal consideration involved. What do you mean by personal consideration? Personal consideration means you only have to perform. If I have promised that I will teach this subject, I only have to teach. My daughter cannot teach, my wife cannot teach, my mother cannot teach. There's a personal consideration involved. So legal heads cannot perform there. Otherwise, legal heads can perform, right? Achha. There's also a possibility that death of offeree also might take place. So if death of offeree takes place, again, before giving acceptance, then so there's no contract. But after acceptance, then again, we'll check out whether there's a personal consideration involved or no. If no personal consideration, then legal heads have to perform. If personal consideration is involved, then legal heads need not. The next, counter offer when it is given, makes the original offer come to an end by not accepting the offer according to the prescribed or usual mode. Okay, if offeror has prescribed, this is the mode by way of which you have to give acceptance, but the offeree is not giving, then it comes to an end, the offer comes to an end. By rejection of offer by the offeree, who knows, offeree himself has rejected this offer, then also the offer comes to an end. By change in law also, it's possible that offer comes to an end, right? This was lapse of offer. Then communication of performance, that means don't just perform, but also see to it that that particular performance is communicated to the other party. So communication is mandatory, correct? This is what we have discussed in offer and acceptance, right guys? I believe all of you are there with me. Guys, I believe all of you are there with me. Hope you have not slept. Oh, great. You're there. Thank you. So let us now quickly recall or revise even the topic consideration, right? Consideration is nothing but the price of the promise, right? The Latin maxim for this is quid pro quo. That is something in return, right? Something in return. So two clause D defines this term consideration. Consideration is an act or abstinence, that is to do something or not to do something. It is done at the desire of the promisor, right? It is done by whom? Promisee or any other person. Then maybe past, maybe present or future, right? If it is already executed, then it is past. If, let's say, it is in the process of execution, then it is present. And if it is, it has to be done in future, then it is obviously future consideration. Okay. Then essential elements of consideration. The consideration must move at the desire of whom? The promisor. An act done by a third party cannot be called as consideration. That means who has to give the consideration? The other party only, or maybe at the most, the other party's agent has to give that particular consideration, correct? Then consideration must be lawful, which depends upon the object. If object is lawful, consideration is also lawful. Then the consideration must be real and not illusory, right? The same examples, bringing star from the sky or running 200 kilometers per hour, that's not possible. Or maybe two parallel lines you say will intersect. No, that's not possible. So it should be real. It should not be illusory. It should have some value in the eyes of law. If you remember fetching a car and the person says, if you fetch that car, I'll give you my new car, or I'll give the same car to you. This is something which is not going to be recognized in the eyes of law. Then the consideration must not be the performance of existing law, legal obligation or contractual obligation. If I'm supposed to do something, see, I'll give you a very simple example now. You have contracted with us, right? We have collected some fee from you. Okay. So now if I say, beta, you have given this 15,000 to me or you have given this 18,000 to me. Now, if you want to get through this examination, you will have to pay 3,000. You'll say, sir, is that 15,000 or 18,000 which I have paid is for failing the examination? No. It is implied that we are supposed to teach there and we have to see to that you get through the examination, you clear the examination. So if I'm asking you 2,000-3,000 extra for passing the examination, that's something which is wrong. I'm contractually bound to give my services in such a way that you should be able to clear your examination. Okay, guys. So I took the example of lawyer in contractual. Now I'm taking my example. I mean, our example. Okay. Something which you're contractually obliged to do. Anyways, you'll have to do it. Okay. Anyways, you'll have to do it. So there can't be any separate consideration or extra consideration there. Right. If it is there, then it is not a valid consideration. Same way, police inspector example we took. He's legally bound to trace out that bike for you. So in that case, if he has not traced it out and he says that you give me extra, then I'll trace it out. That is absolutely wrong because already government is giving him the remuneration. Government is already paying him the salary. Right. Then some other rules we talked about is consideration need not be adequate. See, it is up to the parties to decide what should be the consideration. The law will not have any role there. The court will not have any role there. So don't think that court at the time of enforcement will decide the consideration. It is the parties at the time of doing the agreement will decide, and it need not be adequate. However, we said, when the court has to decide that whether there is free consent involved or not, they will look into various factors to find out whether whether consent was freely obtained or not. So one of the factors which they will look into is nothing but adequacy of consent. Because if there is inadequate consideration, it will give a suspicious circumstance, or maybe there will be a suspicion there that, oh, maybe consent is not obtained freely. They might have applied some coercion under influence. That's why this is the consideration, correct? Then consideration may be furnished by promisee or any other person. Even a stranger can furnish the consideration. Stranger means what? The person who is not a party to the contract. Stranger means what here? Stranger to a contract, not stranger to you. Maybe my brother. I am doing contract with, let's say, Harsha. So Harsha and me are the parties in a contract. But remember, my brother is a stranger to this contract. He is not stranger to me. He is not stranger to Harsha, let's say. But he is a stranger to a contract because he is not a party to the contract. So who knows? I have to give some goods and I ask my brother to give it. That's all right. I have to pay money to Harsha and maybe I say, my brother, you please pay. That's all right. So consideration may be furnished by promisee or any other person. Chinnaya versus Ramya case. Okay, not Ramaya. That is Ramya, if you remember that maternal uncle example. Okay, then consideration may be either positive or negative depending upon the offer. The consideration may be even to forbearance to sue. That means the person says, you don't sue me. Okay, you don't sue me. I will vacate after 3 months of that particular house or place. So that's nothing but the person is saying that you don't sue me means he's asking for what? Not to do something, right? Against that, he will do something for you. So you are doing something, okay? He is doing something, correct? No, he is doing something and you are not doing something. You're saying, I'll not sue you in the court. That's also all right. It's not that always I should do and he also do something, right? No, I might do something, he might not do something, or vice versa also can happen, right? I might say, I will not teach there, you give me rupees 1 lakh. Right. So I am saying that I will not do something. So that's an abstinence for which I'm getting rupees 1 lakh. So the person who's promising 1 lakh, what is he getting in return? Abstinence, my abstinence. Okay. Negative consideration. And the consideration must maybe past, present or future. Right. You remember those examples, past, present, future. Present. The best example for present consideration is what? It's nothing but cash sale. Right. Cash given, goods taken, present consideration for both the parties. Acha. If we don't specify anything, then consideration, we are talking from whose perspective? Always offerer, because at the desire of offerer, right? We say that the contract comes into place because of offerer. So we need to understand that whenever we talk about the consideration, we are talking from whose perspective? We're talking from the perspective of offerer, correct? Future, obviously that means what? Maybe in future, the person will get something. So if he has sent the goods and the other person says, I will pay after 2 months, that's nothing but future consideration, right? So you know that past, present and future consideration. Section 25, an agreement without consideration is void. So that means always an agreement to be valid, to be enforceable, there should be some consideration involved. If there's no consideration involved, then the agreement becomes void. However, there are certain examples. There are certain exceptions. What are those exceptions? Number one, natural love and affection. So if there is some natural love and affection between the parties, then the agreement done between them can be valid. Okay, so out of natural love and affection, let's say father is ready to give to his son, okay, let's say his flat. Okay, that might be valid. That means later on, if father doesn't give that particular flat, son can sue father in court of law. But this is subject to some condition. Okay, some condition. What are those conditions? It must be in writing. Right, it must be registered, it must be based out of natural love and affection. That's why I took father and son's example, two brothers, two sisters. This is natural love and affection. We don't have to love them, right? Whether they're good, bad, it is bound that we will love them. And then the parties are in near relation. That's where we're talking about father, son, brother, sister, two brothers, two sisters, like that. Okay, or maybe husband, wife also later on. Initially no, but later on it bound to love each other, right? Out of my personal experience also, I'm telling you. Then coming to past voluntary services, meaning what? If you remember the example of book, I said maybe someone, some of you is looking out for a book and I find it. and you have not asked me, but still I get that book and I have not got it gratuitously. That means I don't intend to give you as a gift. So I give it and you accept it, then you'll have to pay for it. Okay, you'll have to pay for it. Okay, it's going to be valid. So maybe here again there is a chance that the person might say there's no consideration involved, but still there is valid contract in place. Promise to pay time barred debt. I hope you remember time barred debt. What is it? As per Indian Limitation Act, a creditor can take an action against the debtor for recovery of his money within how much time? 3 years. He can take an action within what time? Three years. But if he's not taking any action during 3 years, then what will happen is the contract will come to an end. The contract will come to an end. That is, the debt is going to become zero there. Time barred. But now let's say that particular debtor comes after 3 years, after the debt becomes time barred, he comes and says, no, I'm going to pay the money. I promise to pay the money. Then what is that he is getting in return? Nothing. But still, law says it is going to be valid. Law says it's going to be valid. Right, guys? But subject to some condition that the promise which he's making should be definite and express, should be in writing, should be signed, should be time barred. Okay? Then gifts actually made. What's the difference between the first point, that is natural love and affection, and this gifts actually made? Only one basic difference. There we are talking about near relatives. Here we are not talking about that. Okay, but again, this is subject to, again, it should be in writing and registered. You remember, no? So I give some gift, let's say to Mayank. Okay, I'm giving my house as gift to him. It should be in writing. It should be registered. Okay, that means that there should be a gift deed in place. So now you will say, sir, if you are giving this house, what did Mayank give you in return? Nothing. But still it's going to be valid because it's covered in exceptions. These are all exceptions given by the law. So under these exceptional cases, though the other party is not giving anything in return to you, still it is valid, but subject to some conditions it is valid. Okay. Same way, creation of agency, meaning what? Somebody is ready to act as my agent and I don't give anything. It's all right. Still, there is a valid contract in place. Contract of bailment. If you remember bailment contract, I took the example of tent house. Right, tent house person who's the owner of chairs supplies some chairs to me, and then in return I pay some hiring charges. Right, that's a contract of bailment, and for a purpose it is given. Once the purpose is over, then I'll return. Like I said, maybe for the purpose of some function I've taken those chairs. Once it is over, then we'll return it. For that, if he's not charging something, then also it is a valid contract. If it is charging, fine, there's no question. Okay, but then not charging also, law says it is covered under exceptions. Same way, contract of guarantee, you know, guarantor or surety will not get anything in return actually from the creditor. But still what happens? Still it is a valid contract. Correct? Then charity, you know, charity will not, if I say I'll pay something, I'll subscribe to something, maybe I will not get anything in return. But still that's a valid contract, provided the other person have done some commitment on the basis of my promise, right? If he has not done any commitment on based on my promise, then that is not a valid contract. So this is again a condition kept. Next one, right? The last one rather in this topic, doctrine of privity of contract. What does privity of contract means? Stranger to a contract. What does doctrine means? A legal principle which is accepted by one and all, which is having universal acceptability, isn't it? So when I talk about privity of contract, that is stranger to a contract, we understand that normally the parties in a contract only can sue each other, not the stranger. So if I have done contract with, let's say, Sanjana, then if Sanjana has not done something, okay, not done what she has accepted, then I will have to sue her, or I can sue her. And if I have not done my part, she can sue me. It cannot be Shruti, it cannot be Mayank who can sue either of us. It is the parties who should sue each other in case of non-performance. Right. However, there are exceptions. That means in these exceptional cases, though a person is not a party to the contract, though a person is a stranger to a contract, still there is a possibility of what? Maybe suing the parties in a contract. Right. Which happens in case of trust, when a beneficiary you talk about can always sue the trustees. Though beneficiary is not a part of that particular contract, but still beneficiary can sue. Then marriage settlement and all, if you remember mother's example, two brothers saying that you will pay some maintenance money to mother. So mother becomes like a beneficiary there. So if brother is not paying, okay, then mother can sue directly that particular son, that particular brother, right? Then acknowledgement of payment, which means what? If I have to pay something, let's say to Mayank, and I say Harsha will pay that amount, and Harsha agrees to this, maybe by way of express means or implied means, then what? Then it becomes a valid contract. Acha, but Harsha, let's say, has part amount, paid part amount, and she's not paying the other part amount. Can Mayank sue Harsha? Yes, it's possible, right? Because of this exception. Though there is no contract, though there is no express contract between Harsha and Mayank, but still Mayank can sue Harsha in case Harsha is not paying later on. Then same way, agreements relating to land. If some buyer of the land is there, maybe he has not done some agreement with the tenant, but still, if tenant is not paying those lease rental means nothing but rent. Okay, so if he is not paying that rent, then can this new buyer sue that particular tenant? Yes. Though there is no contract between the new buyer and the tenant, but still it is possible. Same way, contract through agent. So principal can sue the other party. Though the other party might say, no, you were not a party to the contract. He'll say the agent has acted on my behalf, so I have the right there. Then one more is holder in due course. Remember, in case of negotiable instrument, we said there is a concept of holder. Holder means not just the person who's holding it, but holding in the capacity of payee. That means he is entitled to receive the money, right? That is where he is called as a holder. And that holder who satisfies three conditions will be called as holder in due course. Every holder is not holder in due course. Any holder who satisfies three conditions, which three conditions? That he has taken that instrument in good faith before maturity date and for valuable consideration, then he becomes holder in due course. So the advantage of becoming holder in due course is he can sue any of the prior parties in his own name. Like in our example, if you remember, H can sue in case of that promissory note. H can sue that B if B is not making the payment. Though H and B doesn't have specifically any contract. The contract was between A and B, but now H is able to sue B for the default. So this is again an exception wherein privity of contract comes in, that is stranger to a contract can sue the party. Right, guys. So this is how we have discussed three topics. So this was a quick revision, okay, rapid revision of these topics 1, 2, 3. So now, as we said, our agenda was to first quickly recall that, revise this. Now I would take up your doubts. Okay, so please kindly ping in your doubts. Okay, kindly message your doubt with page number or with topic. Okay, with topic and page number, so that it becomes easy for us to go there and clarify your doubt. Come on, guys. And in case you want to speak, you want to talk to me instead of typing, then you can let me know. I will unmute you. Okay, from here. Come on, guys. If you want to type your message, please type. If you want to speak, right, please let me know. I will unmute you. Come on, are you there, guys?